Hey, welcome back, everybody, to today's Market Explained, a four-star podcast, video series, media event, and a great show. So we are going to do a full show today. My normal co-host, Mr. Chris Reardon, is not with us today. He's on vacation. You know, we let him out once in a while. And so we have our special guest host today is Trader Jack, Jack Walsh. Jack, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks, Bri. Thanks for inviting me. I'm excited to talk about what's going on.
Jack's a father of three, a sports car enthusiast, a experienced trader in the interest rate futures of Chicago Mercantile Exchange. And for the last 15 years, he's been a senior financial advisor. And now he's working with the largest practice at four-star wealth advisors. Again, Jack, you're our guest and guest host. Welcome.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Bri. Let's get started, huh?
Let's get started. I'm Brian Castle, your founder and CEO of Four Star. I'm an Eagle Scout, a trustee of the National Boy Scout Foundation, philanthropic advisor, advisor to CEOs and insiders, and I'm the chief dad to Quinn and Evan, and husband to the amazing Trippy. So if you like what we're hearing, everybody, if you would, go on Apple iTunes. You can give us a ranking. Give us a 5 out of 5, and then forward this podcast to your friends and let them hear it as well. Because the more ownership our listenership that we have, the better it is for our numbers, better it is from the whole program. So we're excited. We're growing on our listenership every episode. So we're excited to see that. So help us with that if you would. I think there are a lot of people that might benefit from some of the things that we're saying. So we're going to do our standard program with Jack today. We're going to talk about the markets, talk about the economy and what we see out there. So normally Chris Reardon talks about the different asset classes and what's going on. I'm going to do that today. And we have 6 major asset classes that we track. And Jack, number 1 is domestic equities. And that is up 3 points this survey since our last episode to 320. So out of the 1,088 tally scores, it is 320, which is approaching a record level. We've not seen the number 1 ranking above 300 that often. The highest read, I believe, was like 340, and it was domestic equities many years ago, but we're at 320. We're up 3 more in the last period since the last show. So that's happening. International equities, which many of the listeners in the show know we talk about quite a bit. We've not had a big move in international equities in 17 years. We had a very small move in 2015, and it faded. But this is a sustained rally now in international equities. We've had about 6 months now of international equities doing well. Ironically, the currencies aren't doing that well. So that means there's really real value in those international stocks because the dollar is still strong. But meanwhile, the international stocks are strong. Usually international stocks move and their currencies move, the dollar terms, but their currency is not moving, but the stocks are moving. So that's up 4 points to 261. That's one of the growth assets. And then the third out of the 6 that's really a growth asset is commodities. And commodities were up 7 points to 203. So we have 3 asset classes above 200 and domestic equities above 300. And those are really big numbers. So we're in a what we call a risk-on market where the risky assets are growing, money's flowing into them. And they would call this, Jack, a classic bull market, wouldn't they?
Yeah. Yeah. And I would just add there that I think that all of those are getting a boost from expectations that the central banks would like to start easing. That might be problematic, but, you know, commodities, international, the one thing that the central banks were able to do is they were able to get rates higher. You know, we went from 0% to 5.25%. And we really didn't have, we had some regional bank problems, but we really haven't had the crisis from that big move. So the central banks do have some power.
Yeah, so that they're moving the risky assets. We're expecting a recession or a slowdown in the economy. But the market is a discounting mechanism long in advance. So the market is already, whatever's going to happen with that slowdown, the market's already reacting to the recovery, which they think will be probably like next fall or something like that. Market's usually 6 months in advance. So looking at the other asset classes, Jack, we have cash, currencies, and fixed income in that order. Cash is down. Money markets, down to 134, down 7 second time period between podcasts that it's down in a row. Currencies are down 6 points to 88. And it's also the second in a row. And then fixed income is down one, also a second time in a row since the last podcast that they're down. So the risky asset classes are up strong. The scaredy cat, the conservative asset, cash, fixed income, and currencies. And, you know, what is currencies? Currencies is cash in somebody else's country. Right? So that's at least an understanding of that. So that's where we are. We're in a risk-on market. It's a bull market. Welcome to the bull market. And, you know, Jack, we often talk about how bull markets climb the wall of worry. Mm-hmm. Because everybody's worried, right? We have two wars going on, might have another. We have a recession looming, possibly, or a slowdown. Lots of concern. We have a presidential election. We have a very divided country. A lot of concerns. A lot of liberty issues now, or people are being canceled, and the courts are kind of correcting those things. So it's kind of a messy time in America, but yet the markets are going up, right? And so that's that wall of worry, Jack. There we are.
Yep. And Bri, I think what kicked that off, well, you and I noticed in late 2023 is when the Fed changed their tune, right? We had the S&P that was up at 48.50. It started to correct on inflation worries, traded down to 41.50. We got a very good inflation number in November of 2023. The Fed in early December basically said that they wanted to pause and were thinking about easing, and you had bonds and stocks shoot up right at the end of the year together. So I mean, so the Fed, the central banks, and the markets realize how important easy money and support from the central banks play. So,
well, Jack, that led to now what is now a rally. So we had two weeks down in the month of March. Month of March is over. First quarter is over as of today. The last trading day being yesterday. I'm sorry, no, Thursday. Today we're taping on Saturday, unusually, very unusually. But earlier, the markets have been down for 2 weeks in a row. That's the first time that happened since October. But then we turned right around and rally has ensued. And now we're at record highs for the S&P and the Dow Jones, right? So people are wondering, you know, we're at record highs. Should we be nervous? And you hear the media talk about it a lot. You know, they talk about, oh, 22 record closes in the first quarter and for the S&P and 17 record closes for the Dow Jones. And so when you think about it, you know, if you're at a high point in the market, whether you're overpriced or not, every time the market goes up, it hits a new high. So you don't really think of that as like something spectacular. Because if earnings keep going up, the markets seem to keep going up. And if you're not recovering from a collapse in the market, then you're at the high end, then you're always going to have a record close. So you wouldn't really, the fact that the media keeps, you know, talking about all these record closes really is not that big of a deal. It's good, obviously, that we're going to highs, but just the fact of the record closes is not something to say, oh my God, we better invest, you know. But that's they try to make it sound that way. So it's a little bit confusing. But just for the record, the first quarter, the S&P was up over 10% in the first quarter. That's a really, really good quarter. That would mean if that kept going, we'd be up 40% for a year. I think we've only had one or two years in the history of the S&P where we've been up 40%. So at that pace, we're at really kind of a record pace. But, you know, the question is, will we continue at that pace? I think likely. We may continue to go up or may go down, but up 10% in a quarter is really good. NASDAQ is up 9% and the Dow is up 5% for the quarter. So last year was led by technology stocks, those Magnificent Seven, and they took the S&P up to new heights and the tech stocks were really strong. But the fact that the NASDAQ was down in the first quarter and the S&P was up higher than the NASDAQ, that tells you that we did have a correction in the technology names. Tesla's down. Amazon is down, Apple's down. So those big names aren't so hot right now. And there's been a broadening out of the market. So there's different segments, not the small caps, but all the other groups. We're seeing utilities run, we're seeing healthcare run, different groups, aerospace, airline. And we're seeing materials and industrial run as well. So we're seeing a lot of good moves in the market. Also, we're seeing, like I mentioned, certain commodities are running. Copper is starting to run. Gold is starting to run. The industrial stocks like Honeywell, Eaton, Teledyne, great names. Those are starting to act really well. And then we're also seeing some trends where the millennials are getting credit cards, the credit card companies, Visa, American Express. They're all doing pretty well. So we've not had a serious pullback since November 1st. So Jack, would you think that we would have a sell-off here? I would think so. You mentioned that concept of a blow-off top. Let's talk about that.
Yeah, Bri, there's a couple times when the market trades like this where people would love to see a pullback, but it doesn't. And, you know, after long bear markets, when investors start to realize that the bottom is in, you know, everybody starts to pile in. And then there are times like now, where I think a lot of people have missed the move. You and I have talked about how much money is on the sidelines. We've got $6 trillion at least in money market accounts. So we could see where there is fuel to the fire here, right? And, you know, if the Fed were to do what you and I would term an unconventional ease, we have relatively low unemployment. We still have relatively high inflation, considering that the Fed's target is 2%. If they were to ease in June and the market were to anticipate two more eases this year, you could see where that flood of money in money markets, with the S&P being up 10%, could start to flow into risk assets. Next thing you know, the S&P is up 12%. It's up 15%. And we could get into a situation where you and I have seen it, where they term it a blow-off top, meaning that even though prices are high and people know that there's speculation, higher prices bring in more money, the market doesn't pull back, and you get a very speculative, what traders would call a blow-off top. Now, what happens in a situation like that is prices drags in more and more participants, it's going to end bad, right? And I think when we talk about the Fed, does the Fed really want to ease with the market at all-time highs? Should they ease? Should the Fed possibly create a bubble and a blow-off top? I think that's a question about debt and deficits. And does the Fed want to try and help out the Treasury here with debt and deficits? Mm-hmm.
So, Jack, we might not ease, or if we ease, we might only ease once or twice then. It's possible. The signaling is we're going to have three eases, right?
Yes, right now, yes.
Okay. But if the economy is strong enough, then maybe we don't have eases, although the economy being strong is a little bit deceptive because we've had record government spending. We had a $2 trillion deficit last year. The Atlanta Fed is estimating that the GDP now, which is a tracker of the estimates of the GDP, will be only 2.3% for the first quarter. And much of that is actually government spending. So if we pull government spending out of it, some, depending on how you calculate, some analysts are saying the GDP is actually negative and we're actually in recession now, albeit for government spending. Or it's going to be a big part of it, at least more than 1%. And so the actual non-government GDP could be less than 1% here, Jack. It's very possible.
Yeah. Well, and that takes us to the point, Bri, that coming out of the December meeting, right, we have gotten easier financial conditions. The Fed hasn't done anything. They've talked about easing. The first thing that the market did, they priced in 6 or 7 eases, right? And the market has been pricing in eases for, you know, almost 2 years, right? And the Fed continually pushes back against what the market is pricing in. So we made the observation weeks ago that just by talking about an ease, financial stocks like Morgan Stanley that were trading at $69, $70 are now trading at $92. So the mere fact of the Fed mentioning ease is loosening financial conditions. And for that reason, maybe they don't have to ease, or maybe they should not ease, right? And that's where, you know, we might want to call that the stop and go Fed, right? Which is something I believe Arthur Burns did in the 70s, right? They basically started the ease too soon, and inflation picked back up and they had to stop. So
that's true. And Jack, just a little history lesson. I think we've mentioned this before in different episodes, but Rick Santelli, the famous reporter for CNBC, came out, and Rick is in our home city here in Chicago, and you know, operates on the floor of the Mercantile Exchange and the Board of Trade. And he talks a lot about what's going on in the markets. He's our market reporter. He had a chart that showed, even though we're at 5% Fed funds rate right now, and that's higher than where it was, certainly for a long time, where we were at zero, based on the trajectory of the move, if we continue to deficit spend, according to Milton Friedman and the trajectory of the chart, we would see the Fed funds rate to as high as 12% from five. Well, if that happened, that would be very catastrophic. Now, the betting is, Jack, that we're going to have a few eases. The economy is slowing down a little bit with ease to get the economy going again. That's like 75-80% chance of that, right, Jack?
Yes. Brian, I would say that the most probable course is that action. Right now, the market, the interest rate market, is pricing in three eases. And, you know, market perceptions change, but yes, I would say that that's about 75-80% probability right now.
But if we keep deficit spending and doing all these things we're talking about that really could hurt the economy, then I'd say 20-25% chance that we could go into a hyperinflation mode. And you know, a lot of countries around the world have gone through that. We went through a little bit of that in the 70s, but they raised interest rates very sharply, very quickly to get that done. It still took 3 years to solve the problem. And by September of 1981, we were at 16.9% on the federal funds rate. And that would be the scenario that Rick Santelli was talking about. And of course, anybody who lived through that era, I was in my late teens, early 20s, and I didn't recognize it as being something that affected me that much. But all our parents were dealing with, the economy was dealing with it. It was a very, very difficult time. And that's when the Farm Aid came out. And I remember the famous rock concerts to help farms. Everybody was struggling at the time. But interest rates were very, very high. It took till basically 1983 to get the economy really back on track. And then the things started to get better in 83, 84. Ronald Reagan was president. He got reelected because then it was morning in America, apparently, because things are getting better. But it was a very, very difficult time. We really hope that we don't go through that again. But the scenario that could lead to that would be continuing government involvement, government spending, overspending, government being a major component of GDP, and getting in the way and crowding out spending that might have been elsewhere, and not letting the market recess to its normal level. So if we had stagnant economy, and we had inflation, that would lead to the 70s famous stagflation, where you really need to let the economy solve its own problems. The tools of the Federal Reserve wouldn't really work that well. And that's what happened in the 70s. They raised interest rates to choke off the growth, but the inflation was a tough master, and it stayed there for a couple of years. And it takes that long to get inflation down in other countries. We've now witnessed the inauguration of Javier Milei in Argentina. And he very, very quickly has gone after many of the government spending issues. He's cut whole departments out of the Argentine government and got inflation down from 100% a month in some cases down to only 10%. It's still much higher than here, but they're on the track to get inflation back to a normal kind of 2-3% level, which normal economies would have. We're going in the other direction, unfortunately, the last 2 months. Interest rates have been rising. And so, interest rates haven't been rising. Inflation's been rising. And the likelihood that rates go lower every time inflation goes higher is less and less. Like Jack, you were saying, there's so many people that have been predicting 5 and 6 interest rate decreases to correspond for what we went through with interest rate increases. Now that's down to 2 or 3. Many people are now saying that we might not see interest rate declines. Some other voices, Dennis Gartman, famous investment advisor, worried about inflation coming back. John Lansky, who's a regular on Fox, not bullish at all. Either earnings are slower and the market pulls back because of that, or rates rise and we have to raise rates because of inflation, the markets pull back. So John's not positive. Jim Bianco, Bianco Research in Chicagoland, inflation concerns. Leon Cooperman in New York, concerned about the debt overhang. So there's a lot of issues out there. We are climbing the wall of worry, but are we going to solve these problems before we have a big correction, or are we going to have a big correction and then solve them? We'll see. Jack, you know, Brent crude oil is back up to $87 a barrel. Those numbers are coming out stronger than oil. And that, of course, oil is a cost input for the economy. So that increases inflation. We saw the February personal spending numbers up 0.8% versus an expected 0.5%. And then the income levels were lower. So if income is down, but spending is up, that means we're deficit spending or spending savings or other things. So that's not necessarily a positive. And a lot of that increase in personal spending is because of inflationary goods. So we're seeing that that would lead us to believe inflation might come back. And then also the jobs numbers that were touted to be so good, December and January, both revisions were downward, not upward, down 175,000 jobs. So there's a lot to worry about here, everybody. We hope that that more rosy scenario happens. Inflation does come back and start easing instead of going back upwards like it has for the last 2 months. Jack, that's what we're praying for, isn't it?
Yes, yes, Bri. And you know what? This is not textbook circumstances, right? I mean, we added $1 trillion in debt in 100 days, right? So, you know, my concern is that, and we'll see it play out in the currency markets. I'm not that concerned about the currency markets right now. I think if the Fed is a stop and go Fed and they dribble out 1 or 2 rate cuts, that's going to provide confidence for bond investors to buy some bonds, right? That's also probably going to boost stocks, which will give a wealth effect, right? Which is going to help the economy. And I think the big thing about that is if the Fed does start in an easing pattern, it probably produces capital flows into the U.S. You know, the fact that U.S. stocks are at 302, or was it high 290s on the daily scores, right? That means that still globally, the U.S. is the best place to invest, right? And those capital flows into the U.S. keep the U.S. dollar stable. What I would be concerned about, if the Fed starts to cut rates and we see the yield curve start to steepen and we really start to see bond prices fall, I'm talking about 20 and 30 year bonds fall, right? That could have an adverse effect on the US dollar. And then what do we get? We get capital outflows. That would be the 1970s. That would be the Rick Santelli scenario. So we definitely know what to watch to see whether we're having capital inflows or capital outflows. Let's hope that the Fed can engineer a soft landing. Let's hope that they can engineer 2 or 3 cuts. That's going to be able to really help the Treasury and the interest on the debt. That would be a great thing. But you and I both know that this would be a very unconventional way to start a so-called easing cycle. I don't even think they're going to call it an easing cycle, Bri. I think they're going to say that they're too tight now and they're just moving the funds rate to something that is more neutral. They're not even going to call it easing. So,
well, it's interesting. If the interest cost of the government goes over $1 trillion per year, and our budget only recently was $4 trillion, now it's up to about $7 trillion, but running $1.5 to $2 trillion deficits, that will crowd out a lot of spending. And if interest rates go higher, that $1 trillion number will be reached very quickly because we'll have higher interest rates to pay. As it is, people aren't buying the 10 and 20 and 30 year bonds at the levels that they've been offered. They've had to offer higher interest rates, so they're offering less and less long-term bonds. So it's going to affect us in the short run in the T-bills and the short-term note market as well. So, you know, that's really, really an issue. We have so much debt right now. When President Bush was inaugurated in year 2000, 24 years ago, we only had $5 trillion in debt. And many people were concerned about that. He added some debt. President Obama added some debt. President Trump added debt. Biden's adding a lot of debt. So it's gone really kind of haywire. Now we could grow out of the debt. That's possible through inflation. And that's partly what happened in the 70s. But, you know, just that enough, there's not enough, not enough inflation that could really solve our debt problem. Now we have to be defaulting on debt, which we don't want to do, you know, certainly. So a good president, a good leader might say, hey, we need to pay down some of this debt. And that's exactly what they did after World War II. They actually paid down debt by running surpluses in the government. And they knew they had to run surpluses when it's not wartime. Another thing we could do in America is we literally have seen an explosion of government in the last 50 years with more and more departments and more intrusive activities into our life. And that those committees and organizations have bought more and more buildings and assets and land. We control more than half of the land in the Western states. So they could sell a lot of that land. They could sell buildings. They could sell it to private industry. And they could still regulate it, right? But they wouldn't own it. We can get the money out and pay down our debt. So a good president probably would do that, attempt to pay down, let's say, $10 trillion of the debt, back, get back into the low 20s in debt. And then that's a more manageable number that would cut our interest costs by close to a third, maybe a quarter to a third. That would be a good thing to do. So those are ideas. And so what could that mean if we don't solve this debt problem? America's never really had a time where we've had a long, long-term economic decline. The Depression was bad, but the markets did react a little bit better, Jack. We weren't even alive back then, right? But we've studied history. And, you know, you say to yourself, well, we've never had a three-year bear market in America, or at least in modern finance times. So is that possible? Could we have a three-year bear market? Well, certainly it's possible. And in fact, one good example in history, a sad example actually, is after the extreme leverage of the 1980s, the Japanese market topped out in 1989. And just recently, the Japanese market hit a new high. The last new high, this new high was in January, last new high was in 1989. They had a 30-year bear market in Japan. So is that possible here? Well, we would like to believe it's not possible, but actually anything is possible. So what if we have so much debt that it hamstrings our government, hamstrings our ability to lead our nation? Our currency would no longer be the reserve currency, because if we're mired in debt, other countries will take leadership from us because we're kind of solving our debt problem. So, you know, unfortunately, there have been examples in world history and recent modern finance terms where the country's financial issues got so bad that it caused a major disruption. In the case of Japan, a major world economy, one of the biggest economies in the world, had a 30-year bear market. So let's hope that doesn't happen here, Jack, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, I mean, you know, debt cycles, Brian, that's what's interesting when you hear about the Leon Coopermans and the Ray Dalios and the Paul Tudor Jones, right? They love this study, economic history, right? And there's certain things that are typical of debt cycles, right? One of them is massive income inequality. And, you know, and how are they going to solve that, right? I think one thing that all people of assets, whether they be big financial assets or small financial assets, we worry about taxes, right? The one thing that I would say about the economy now and the markets right now, that as long as the dollar is relatively stable, as long as stock markets are making new all-time highs, there's that wealth effect. And it doesn't seem like there's a crisis. You and I know that the amount of debts is not sustainable. And you have Leon Cooperman and other people mentioning that within the next couple of years, you know, something has to happen. But I'm not sure that anything productive happens until we have a crisis, right? And the other thing that people worry about at the end of debt cycles is they can produce wars. And we've got a hotspot, Ukraine, Middle East is a big problem. There's always concern about China, Taiwan. And these are typical of debt cycles.
Yep.
And so I guess the question for listeners is, how do we know when this is going to start to take place? And that's why we continue to watch bond markets and we watch currencies. I think it's very interesting that both gold prices and Bitcoin are rallying at the same time. So even though the dollar looks stable, it's not so stable against what people consider hard currency like gold and silver and Bitcoin. The only thing I would say about that is that, you know, maybe people should have some alternatives. Maybe people should have some real estate. You always know that there's a crisis coming, but predicting a crisis or investing for the end of the world has never really made sense. So
we'll do the, we do the best we can. We're going to talk about diversified alternatives in a short moment, Jack. In the what we see out there section, Sam Bankman-Fried finally was sentenced to 25 years in prison, and he's going to have to give back $11 billion, of course, which he does not have, but they had to get that out on the record. You know, this was the biggest financial fraud in history, and it's an amazing situation that any one person and team could be that reckless with literally tens of billions of dollars of investor money. We're happy to see that he did get what's coming to him. Very, very sad for all the people who lost money. But nonetheless, that came out this week. We just wanted to highlight that to everybody. And then also, there's lots of talk about this app, TikTok. And we actually use TikTok at 4Star as well. And TikTok is a great tool. A lot of companies use it to advertise and make money using TikTok. By informing their customers and making sales and everything using TikTok. So it's a really good app. The problem is it's run and owned by the Chinese government. And most is we see the aggressive nature of the Chinese government and they're buying land and doing other things to weaken America, their stated goal, outwardly stated goal. So we believe that they're using that to spy on Americans as well. So in a very interesting move, this past week, the House of Representatives voted 352 positive votes to change the ownership of TikTok. Now everyone is saying, "Oh, they're trying to ban TikTok." They're not trying to ban TikTok. What they're trying to do is get new leadership and ownership. The Chinese government owns it. They're going to use it for their selfish ends. What our government is attempting to do is attempting to get U.S. ownership. So Kevin O'Leary, actually of Shark Tank, and you know, a lot of other shows. He's always on financial shows. Kevin O'Leary's talking about making a bid to buy TikTok, and we'd have U.S. ownership. Kevin's a U.S. citizen now, I believe. He was a Canadian, but nonetheless, it wouldn't be a Chinese investor that owns it, or Chinese government owned by the Chinese government. So it's not a ban. They're just trying to change ownership, and I think that would be the right thing to do. It's going now to the Senate, and it'll probably be signed by the president. Ironically, a lot of people are using it, but we want to make sure it's in hands where they're not using it to spy on the American people, which is what most people think is going on there. And Jack, you mentioned a little bit about crypto. You call it digital gold, right? That's moving up big time.
Right. No, the crypto has had a really nice run. In fact, the lows were put in with the whole Bankman-Fried, you know, fraud. And I would say this, Bri, that I've watched the precious metals markets, and now you have Bitcoin ETFs and all of that sort. So I would call it the financialization of crypto, right? So people, if the ETFs were buying Bitcoin one-to-one and you had all this supply coming in, right, then I would say that it's a very bullish scenario. I think short-term, it is very bullish for digital gold. But as the markets become financialized, there is more derivatives, meaning that there is more short-term supply. So you have something that was very scarce because of the amount of different investment in vehicles that someone could get involved in. It's adding to short-term supply. So I see digital gold kind of going the way of regular gold, and people that invest in gold, there's so many different derivatives to invest in. Some people like to invest in the ETF that has the physical, right? And you are an investor in Bitcoin, and you did all of your work, right? And you're not invested in a ETF. You are invested in the real thing.
The real thing, that's right. And it's been an incredible growth scenario. And it's just a reflection of people concerned about regular currencies. There's never been a currency that's lasted more than 225 years in world history. We did some studying on that at University of Chicago. So the American currency has been without collapse longer than any currency in world history. And let's hope we can keep it that way. The trend we're on would not lead us there. The trend right. was negative. And let's hope that American government can figure this out and not let our currency fall into complete decline.
And many smart people on currencies, when we talk about the decline of the dollar, they're like, what's going to take its place? And there is nothing right now, right? So it's, people have been talking about this since the 1990s. People have been talking about debt since I went to the floor of the Chicago Mercantile Exchange in the 80s, right? It has not been a good play to bet against the dollar.
Well, and whenever America is not strong, the world gets into conflicts. We're seeing that now with two wars going, expecting another one in Taiwan sometime soon, China going to Taiwan. So there's lots of hurt in the world. There's lots of concern in the world. So that's also playing into our strategy that whenever people are concerned about the rest of the world, they come back to America. They need money to America. They invest in America. And they need dollars. You said, Jack, that close to 50% of all world transactions are done in the U.S. dollar, even though we're a small fraction of the world.
Yeah, there are some concerning developments, right? For the longest time, it was the petrodollar, and now we hear that China is buying oil in yuan, and countries are setting up trading relationships to move away from the dollar. One thing that came out of the Russian conflict is, us sanctioning them with SWIFT, which is the global payments. Okay. So I think we've done some things that haven't helped the dollar, but I don't think that right now that there's a alternative.
Yeah. Well, let's pray that we maintain our leadership in world economics, and our currency maintains leadership, and that we don't do anything to snub our own toe, which most governments eventually do. Let's hope we're smarter than that. And we have to pray for our country, pray for our leaders, and hope things go well. So a couple more things. Proactive healthcare is the subject of a blog post on Leadership Matrix. If you go onto fourstarwealth.com and scroll down to the blogs, I write a blog periodically every couple of weeks. And there's one in there about if we were to change our healthcare system to being one of reactionary, solving problems after they've happened. How about we do proactive healthcare? Very interesting articles from University of Chicago's survey review about how we would change our healthcare system. And there's lots of talk about the need to do that. So have a look at that article if you would. And then also, I wanted to put up on the screen for everybody, those of you who are watching on YouTube or in other mediums on a system, the Diversified Alternative Funds. We talked about alternatives. And the reason why I'm putting this up on the screen is many investors do better than the stock market and the bond market by using alternatives. But you can do it wrong. And a lot of people over-concentrate in certain alternatives. So the most important thing to remember when you do alternative investing is to make sure you're well diversified in, you know, 20 or 25 different investments. But most people never, ever get to that level. So we created a program called the Diversified Alternative Funds at Four-Star to enable investors with as little as $100,000 to have a diversified alternative portfolio. And it can be in real estate. It can be in private credit, private equity, angel investing. I have up on the screen. The Opportunity Fund has a real estate program, a private equity program, an angel early stage program. That's probably the only place on the financial world through an organized investment advisor firm or brokerage firm that you can get an angel investment. So it's a fully diversified bucket program of investing in angel investing. Also, the Diversified Income Fund is a private credit program, currently paying about 11%. Many people are using that as a replacement for some, but not all of their bond investments. There's the Energy Income Program, which is primarily oil drilling, oil related. And then because of the depreciation allowances, the income you get is tax favored, tax free in some cases. So that's paying about 8%. And then the growth and income bucket has 50% real estate and 50% other, whether it be fast food franchising, wireless assets, cannabis is in there possibly. We've got jet leasing and other non-real estate businesses. So you can get an average return, should be able to, about 15% or better. In many cases, it's better. The angel segments have averaged in the high 20s, private equity in the low 20s, percent return on average per year. So there's great opportunity in alternatives. Most people don't do it right. This is our attempt to help investors do it right. So if you're interested in learning about the Riverside Alternative Funds, call our office, 312-667-1750. Send me a note and we'll make sure that you get hooked up with this program. This is not an offer to buy or sell. It's just an informational thing. There is a formal offering document that we'll send you that will be the formal offer to buy or sell. Okay, let's leave it there, everybody. We appreciate you being with us. And we'll be back in a couple of weeks with an update. Let's hope things go well. For those having Easter this weekend, have a fine Easter, and we'll talk to you in April. Thanks, everybody.